Hello learners, I welcome you all in yet another lesson of D.El.Ed program, course code 509, unit 9 on assessment in social sciences. The today's topic is developing rubrics for assessment in social sciences, a demonstration. But before moving on the topic, let me share with you the proposed flow of the lesson. In the beginning, I would share with you the lesson guide, the expectation in terms of learning objectives. Then we will discuss about the alternative assessment, its concept and need. Then we are also going to discuss about alternative assessment, methods available. We will also discuss about rubrics for performance based assessment. We will recapitulate at the end and there would be a take home task. Now moving towards the lesson guide. During the presentation, I will explain and exemplify the different concepts. You should follow my voice and the slides as well. You will find important words and sentences, etc., have been highlighted to facilitate retention. I have also summarized the main points at the end to have a quick glance for better retention. There are some questions or exercises in between and at the end of my presentation. You are advised to attempt these questions or exercises after going through this video lesson. Now, moving towards the learning objectives or spelling the expectations after the completion of this video lesson. After the completion of this video lesson, you would be able to understand the concept and need of alternative assessment in social science. You would be also able to gain information of different alternative assessment methods in social science. You will be also get acquainted with the skills to develop rubrics for performance based assessment. Now, there is a context in which your help is required. Rahela, a 7th grade student, is feeling upset of being unable to attempt all the questions in her social science examination due to her writing speed. At the same time, she felt satisfied of what she attempted as per what she has asked in the question, which other student of the class has not done. She was surprised to see the result, as she was at par with those students who had attempted all the items. In fact, she was a little better in scores. Could you tell how and why it happened? Yes, it happened due to the systematic approach of assessment used by the evaluator to evaluate the answer script, in which beyond the content knowledge which Rahela possessed, her organizational, analytical, synthetical, evaluative, expressive, summary and argumentation skill, etc., had also been valued. The result clearly indicated her potential to outshine the fellow students if she had been assessed through alternative methods of assessment. Before moving towards the alternative methods of assessment or what assessment is, let me discuss with you that what is required to be assessed when we talk about the performance of a student which is eligible to be assessed. We need to assess children's learning in subject areas. We need to assess children's skills, interests, attitudes and motivations. We need to assess children's participation in social activities. We need to assess children's response to different situations and or opportunities both in and out of the school. We need to assess children's participation in co-curricular activities. After clarifying what to assess, now the question is why to assess. The assessment should be done to find out what learning and changes is taking place in the student. Assessment can also be done to identify the individual needs and requirements. Assessment can also be done to plan teaching learning process in more suitable manner, to help the child to understand about what he or she know or can do, to find out the extent of achievement of objectives, to improve teaching learning process, to communicate the children's progress, to do away with the fear of assessment among children, and to encourage and support children to learn together. After answering that why assessment is required, let me discuss with you that how the assessment can be done. Student performance could be recorded and projected in better manner if the assessment is continuous, comprehensive and through combination of traditional and alternative methods. When we talk about the methods available for assessment, we need to discuss about the different methods which are available for the assessment. We can develop assessment indicators. There are alternative assessment methods which are available for assessment of learning in social sciences, under which we are having creative writing, acting, dancing, picture reading, children's drawing, field visit, portfolio assessment, and rubrics for performance-based assessment. Many more could be added to this list, as this list is not exhaustive. Now coming on, what are rubrics for performance-based assessment? The meaning of the rubric is, or the rubric can be understood as a scoring tool created by experts, teachers, or both teacher and student for assessment of students' performance in any specific area, including curricular subject, curricular activities, other curricular areas, or socio-personal qualities. So any area of child's personality or performance could be assessed by developing the rubrics for assessment. Rubric can also be understood as a set of criteria and standards which are related to learning objectives that is used to assess students' performance or students' assignment. So it's a set criteria, it's a systematic structured criteria on which the assessment of the performance is made. It's not ambiguous, and at the many a time we can also standardize this. Now the question comes, how we can use rubrics, or why we use rubrics for assessment? Rubrics allow for standardized evaluation according to the specified criteria, making grading simpler and more transparent. It is a scoring guide that seeks to evaluate a student's performance based on the sum of full range of criteria than a single numerical score. When we give marks to a student, we are going to determine his or her future based on that single numerical score. It is not exemplifying or communicating about what he or she has done in other areas. So rubric allows us to assess students' performance based on a full range of criteria rather than a single numerical score. A rubric is a working guide for student and teacher. When they are working together, it directs them, it directs their effort. It gives continuity into their effort. It gives clarity to their efforts. So we can say that rubric is a working guide. Step by step, both the student and teacher can refer to the rubric which has been developed in the line of the objectives of that particular content or related to that content for assessment and to develop the work assigned to them or for the development of teaching and learning. So that working guide usually handed out before the assignment begins. The teacher or the student and teacher together develop the rubric and share it before the assignment begins. In order to get student to think about the criteria on which their work will be judged. So the rubric makes the judgment or the assessment crystal clear. It also includes the element of unbiasedness into the assessment. The nature of rubrics, as far as its nature is concerned, the rubric can be understood as an analytical or holistic, and they can be created for any content area including maths, science, history, writing, drama, art, music, etc. Rubric is a formative type of assessment because it becomes an ongoing part of the whole teaching and learning process. At intermittent periods, regularly during our classroom, we give different kind of assignment, we give different kind of projects to our students, and those assignment and projects and activities and tasks could be assessed through the development of rubrics. Students themselves are involved in the assessment process through both peer and self-assessment. When they are having full-fledged criteria, developed criteria in their hand for the assessment and for the development of their task, for the performance, they can assess themselves on their own, and they can also gauge upon their peers' assessment effectively and efficiently. As students become familiar with rubric, they can assist their teacher in the rubric design process. Day by day, they grow. Day by day, they emerge. Day by day, they learn that how to break a task into smaller pieces, how to have reference to the objectives of learning, and how to move further. So, the student, after getting acclimatized with the development of rubric once, twice or thrice, can also provide assistance to their teacher in developing the rubrics. Now, there is a demonstration on the rubric, how we can develop or use rubric. On your screen, I have exemplified a rubric which is developed to assess a project report prepared by the student. The first column of the rubric exemplifies the category or the indicator. The second column, third column, fourth column and fifth column identify or demonstrate the scores which have been accorded to each of the performance category. For example, 4 is accorded to excellent, 3 is accorded to very good, 2 is accorded to satisfactory, and 1 is accorded to need improvement. And along each of the category, the reason for the accordance or the distribution of mark or the score has been given. For example, as far as the first category, the category of organization is referred to, 4 would be given to a student whose information in the project is properly organized and well connected, paragraphs and under subheadings. 3 would be provided to a student who has organized and well connected the paragraph, but in a manner which is inferior than the student who is getting 4. 2 would be accorded to a student whose information is organized but paragraphs are not well connected. And 1 would be accorded or given to a student whose information appears to be disorganized. The second category in the rubric for assessment of a project report is amount of information. What is the amount of information which the student is putting in the assignment? 4 would be distributed to a student or the group of students whose all topics are addressed and all questions are answered with at least 2 sentences about each of the topic or the question. 3 would be given to a student in whose assignment all topics are addressed and most questions are answered with at least 2 sentences about each of the question. 2 would be given to a student in whose assignments all topics are addressed and most question answered with 1 sentence about each of the question. And 1 would be accorded or given to a student in whose assignment one or more topic was not addressed. The third category, the quality of information, that what is the quality of information which the student is representing or giving in the assignment. 4 would be given to a student in whose assignment the information clearly relates to the main topic. It includes several supporting details and or examples. 3 would be given to a student in whose assignment information clearly relates to the main topic. It provides one or two supporting details or examples. Two would be given to a student in whose assignment information clearly relates to the main topic, but no detail or examples are given. And one would be given to a student in whose assignment information has little or nothing to do with the main topic. Moving on the fourth category, the grammatical standard. That what kind of sentence structure, what kind of sentence connection, what kind of vocabulary a student is using in his or her assignment. Four would be given to a student in whose assignment no grammatical or spelling or punctuation errors have been occurred. Three would be given to a student in whose assignment almost no grammatical error or spelling error or punctuation error have existed. Two would be given to a student in whose assignment a few grammatical or spelling or punctuation errors are there. But one would be provided or given to a student in whose assignment many grammatical or spelling or punctuation errors are there. Moving on the next category, which is graphic organizer, that what kind of pictures and graphics have been used in the assignment and whether those are relevant or not. So, four would be given to a student in whose assignment graphic organizer or outlines have been completed and shows clear logical relationship between all topics and subtopics. Three would be given to a student in whose assignment graphic organizers or outlines has been completed and shows clear logical relationship between most topics and subtopics. Two would be given to a student in whose assignment graphic organizer or outline has been started and includes some topics and subtopics. And one would be provided to a student in whose assignment graphic organizer or outline has been started. Now, moving on the next category, which is diagrams and illustration, what kind of diagrams and illustrations have been used in the assignment? Four would be accorded to a student in whose assignment diagram and illustrations are neat, accurate, and add to the reader's understanding of the topic. Three would be given to a student in whose assignment diagram and illustrations are accurate and add to the reader's understanding. Two would be given to a student in whose assignment diagrams and illustrations are neat and accurate and sometimes add to the reader's understanding of the topic. And one would be provided to a student in whose assignment diagrams and illustrations are not accurate or do not add to the reader's understanding of the topic. So, it has been well exemplified that depending on the nature of the content or depending on the nature of the project or assignment, we can develop rubric, we can have different kind of categories under which the assessment could take place. And on the basis of this rubric, you can develop many more. Now, to move on with the advantages of rubric, why the rubrics to be used for assessment of students. The use of rubric can improve students' performance by clearly showing the students how their work will be evaluated and what is expected from them. The use of rubric can also help students to become better judge of the quality of their own work because they are already having a standardly developed criteria in front of them, which they can use to specify the expectations which are posed by a teacher or by a system on them, and they can look on that whether they are trying or they are able to meet those expectations or not. Then use of rubric also allow assessment to be more objective and consistent. The student can compare themselves in positive sense as they are having uniform criteria for the assessment. So we can say that assessment is more objective and consistent when we use rubric. The use of rubric can also force the teacher to clarify his or her criteria in specific terms, and it would rather help the teacher to remove the biasness in his assessment or her assessment or evaluation, and also during teaching. And thereby it gives chance to all the students to excel and flourish. The use of rubric also reduces the amount of time teacher spends evaluating student work, as he or she is already having a developed criteria, developed set of criteria in front of him or her. He or she can use that criteria to objectively assess the student without wasting the time. The use of rubric can also promote students' awareness about the criteria to use in assessing peer performance, so they can compare themselves with each other in positive sense. Use of rubric also provide useful feedback to teacher regarding the effectiveness of the instruction. It helps the reflection process of the teacher. So, next time the teaching would be improved. The teacher would be able to fill the gaps which may be there in the teaching. The use of rubric can also provide students with more informative feedback about their strength and areas where they need the improvement. Use of rubric can be done easily, and rubrics are easy to explain, or the assessment which happen through the use of rubric are easy to explain and also easy to accept by both the students as well as the teachers and other stakeholders. So, at the end, it can be said that rubrics improve students' end products and can therefore increase the learning outcome. To sum up, we can say that it is a high time to think of introducing alternative methods of assessment in our educational institution. These practices, for example, creative writing, acting, dancing, portfolio assessment, field visits, picture reading tasks, rubrics for performance-based assessment, etc., not only take into account the social realities, but also make the evaluation exercise activity-based, participatory, and joyful. Alternative assessment procedures are based upon constructivist principle of knowledge construction. Fundamental focus of such procedures lies on learners' ability for creative expression and proficiency in real life tasks and activities. Assessment in social science, therefore, does not have to be limited to only paper and pencil test. Assessment can be done through a variety of methods such as drama, picture reading task, project and experimentation, portfolio, rubrics, children's drawing, and even dialogue with children. Therefore, acquaintance with all these alternative methods for teachers and prospective teachers of social sciences is required. This lesson thereby made an attempt to demonstrate the importance of alternative assessment method along with specific focus on rubric for performance-based assessment. Now, it's time to take home task for you. You are required or advised to develop a rubric for assessing an assignment on pollution to be given by the 7th grade student. Now, it's time to take home task. You are advised to develop a rubric for assessing an assignment on pollution to be done by the 7th grade students. We will meet again in the next lesson. By then, thank you very much.